We are gonna make it on through. Ooh.
Bless it.
Awesome. Well, welcome world. How are we doing today?
Awesome.
All right. Awesome. So today is Dr. Martin Luther King's birthday. We're going to celebrate that today just because we've gone so far since that sacrifice that he's made. So today I have the pleasure of having an awesome guest on our show. And first of all, I want to just say thank you, Brother Victorious, for being here today.
No problem.
Because you could have been, you know, doing so many other things, but you took the time out your busy schedule to be here. So I'm going to introduce Brother Victorious Hall. He is an awesome man. Somebody I've watched for a very long time. Me growing up, you know, I learned a lot of things from him. And he's an awesome husband, a father, an educator. He is also an academic dean at Oxon Hill Middle School. And so he's doing a lot of things in our community to just raise up our young brothers and our young sisters as well. So, like I said before, I just want to say thank you so much for being here.
Thank you. Thank you for the invite.
And you are Miss Lady?
I am the Queen T. Look, I'm saying so many great things about him, I forgot to introduce the world to me. So, yes, the Queen T, I am here today on this wonderful Monday. Happy Monday, all.
Yes.
And also to my right, this awesome gentleman right here. Roland Grimes.
You have a new fan. How's everybody? Roland Bubba Grimes here, your chocolate date every Monday night from 6 o'clock p.m. to 8 p.m. So we squeeze Queen T here with me at 6 o'clock p.m. Glad to see you, brother.
Thank
you.
I'm happy to be here. It's an honor to be here.
We're having fun already, aren't we?
Yeah, already. Already. I love the introduction.
Awesome. Go on, sister. Do your thing.
All right. Awesome. So in honor of Black History Month, well, not Black History Month, but it feels like it, Black History Day, the celebration of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., I wanted to bring you on because I know that the world, you know, we're transitioning right now out of the president that we have. So to me, that's history. Before my grandfather passed, he was 83 years old, and he said he's just happy that he was able to see a Black president.
Oh, wow.
I know that Dr. Martin Luther King has made a lot of impact to make that even happen today. So I wanted to have you come on because, you know, you are an educator, so that's something that you're passionate about. I see it. I've seen different videos of you, you know, speaking to our young brothers and our young sisters in the community, and honestly, people have questions, you know, transitioning out of this president with this new president. We don't know.
Yeah.
We don't know. So any type of encouragement because then and now, I always say then and now, you know, how we were then, where we are now, what's changing, what's the same, you know, because there's a little bit of the same that's still going on today.
Yeah. So I'm not, you know, I'm not as up in arms about the transition. Because, you know, in studying history, you understand that the presidents of the United States have always been, you know, iffy, right? Have always been, I think the first, nine owned us, like actually owned people, right? So when you think about the things that we lived through and the ways in which we fought back, one thing that has never left our people and people of color in general is that we fight, you know what I mean? We've always resisted against oppression. We've always resisted against people who've tried to, you know, disrespect our legacy. And I think Martin Luther King is a perfect example of resistance, right? A perfect example of what it looks like when you are concerned about your community and concerned about the progression of, you know, children in the future. And I think for me, and the advice that I continue to give to my people is that this ain't no different. I mean, and we've been prepared for this fight, and it ain't necessarily going to change just because one guy's in the office, right? Because we've been fighting against people like him since we hit these shores.
That's
you know,
true.
So
that's
I'm
true.
Not scared at all.
Oh,
I'm
yeah,
not,
no.
You know, not one bit. Not one bit.
No, we shouldn't fear. We should definitely just be prepared.
Yeah,
and
keep
you
fighting.
You never know.
Yeah.
You never know what's to come. So... So really quickly, before we go into depth, I do want to know, what would you like the world to know about Brother Victorious Hall?
That I'm a regular dude. I think one of the biggest things, I'm a regular brother who's trying his best to put his foot forward and try to be better than I was the day before. I think that there's a lot of things that I'm trying to do that I'm trying to first organize myself and get myself together so that I can empower my community and empower the youth. So I think the biggest thing that I want people to know about me is that I'm trying.
Okay.
You know, I'm trying to be better. I'm trying to grow each and every day. And I'm, you know, hopefully by me growing and doing the things that I need to do, other people might see it and, you know, think that that's inspiring and actually do the same.
All right. Awesome. Well, I do want to say that you do inspire me. One thing that I know, you know, your commitment level in doing the things that you say you're going to do is, to me, is honorable.
I appreciate
that. And, you know, me seeing some of the transitions, even to cutting your hair and just the transition of growing.
Yeah.
You know, I see that and I admire that. And that's the one reason I wanted you to come on the show.
I appreciate that.
And plus your level of knowledge, the things that you know, I know that you can offer something of value to other people who may not have studied, who may not took the time to take those years in school and just really, really learn.
Yeah.
And I know you come from a great background as well. So
yeah.
Could you talk a little bit about that?
I mean,
that right there is, to me,
That's
awesome.
I come from a family of, you know, five brothers, a sister, a powerful, powerful mother, an amazing father, and you know, I come from Forestville. I'm from Forestville, so you know, I've been pushed by, you know, a pretty interesting community of people, and I think You know, I was able to matriculate through Suitland and get my undergraduate degree in Morgan and Africana history, and I had some amazing teachers along the way. So my entire community, my wife is an amazing, intelligent woman. So a lot of people around me have kind of pushed and helped to mold. Anything that you see in me is, you know, is actually gifts that I've gotten along the way from people who've kind of been there for me. So, you know, I've been raised in the great streets of Fordsville. But at the same time, you know, I've been nurtured by some powerful, powerful people.
Okay.
Yeah.
So when could you say, because I know you said you studied Africana studies, mm-hmm. and for that, when did it first hit you that you were passionate about, you know, serving your people, just growing and just educating others of the things that you know?
Very interesting story. I was working at JCPenney when I was in high school. I was working in the Simply for Sports department, and my supervisor, his name was Ronald Roop, and I wanted to take his job. So he was like the only white guy who worked in the store, and he was the boss, the top guy. And I was like, you know what? I'm gonna go to school and I'm gonna take your job. Oh, nice. So when I went to school, I majored in business at first, but I knew that was I found out very quickly that that was a shallow goal, because I started taking business classes and I was failing them joints.
Okay.
And, but at the same time, I was taking history classes and I was also mentoring in Baltimore City my freshman year. And I was passing my history courses and I was very interested in it. And I was doing a very good job of mentoring with my job. And I was like, you know what? Because I've had such a, you know, this idea, what I really want to do is not what I want to do. And I fell into something that I love, which was history and teaching.
Okay.
And I became a history teacher.
Awesome. Yeah. Awesome. Now, you know, this is Martin Luther King's birthday celebration day. Is there something that actually, you know, that he did that you watched and you saw over the history courses that you took that really struck out to you about that particular gentleman?
Yeah. So a lot of people like to coin me as the militant man. Okay. Like, you know what I mean? I was super extra, mega, ultra militant, right? And at times in my life, and I still feel like I am. So when I first started studying Martin Luther King, I didn't understand the scope of his power.
Okay.
And so I was more into the likes of Huey P., Marcus Garvey, Elhaj Malik Shabazz. Like, I was kind of in that, and I thought that, you know, from my very limited understanding of history, I thought that was, you know, if I'm a ride like this, I ain't nonviolent. You know what I mean? Somebody come at me, I'm coming at them. You know, I'm from Fordsville, that kind of thing, right? But I quickly began to understand the power in King, right? Mm. The power in being able the power in being nonviolent, right? So just think about that, right? Like, somebody hits you, your ultimate reaction is, I'm about to wail off, right? So just the power in being able to control your mind, your spirit, and your body for a greater cause, right? And so Martin Luther King quickly became, and my son, King Victorious, is very into Martin Luther King. Mm. He's very into his ideas, some of the things that he's done. He's just checked out a book on Martin Luther King like last week. I'm awesome. So proud of him. Awesome. But it helped me to see, like, you know, you understand his greatness. You are able to understand the power that he's had in order to transform an entire nation of people to begin to, you know. And I think that one of the biggest things that he did is he was able to get people to see their own demons, right? And their own inconsistencies spiritually. Mm. And he did that in a variety and number of ways. And, you know, I've always been impressed. You know, as I learned more and started reading his speeches and reading the things that he's done, I became very impressed with the power it takes in order to be nonviolent.
That is deep. You know, because like you said, when somebody puts their hands on you, you're just ready.
The natural reaction is to wail off.
But as I've even grown spiritually, you know, and certain things, because when you start to grow spiritually, you start to be attacked in different ways that you didn't even know were going to come. And that has happened, you know, recent to me, you know, and I'm like, you're going to try to attack me?
Yeah.
So I'm just like, okay.
Yeah, but I also realize where I am as a 35-year-old man. I ain't quite king. I ain't quite made it to the mountaintop. But you know what I mean? But at the same time, You know, we all got a job to do. And we all trying to perfect ourselves and get better each day.
Every day. And it can be challenging, but you know, it's well worth it. So now when we talk about, you know, some of his speeches, you know, so his biggest, one of his biggest speeches, you know, I have a dream. Would you say that that dream has been realized today?
Oh, no, of course not. We got a lot of work to do. and I think, you know, the theme of I have a dream, like I when I teach this to my students, like I say Martin Luther King had a dream, but what he had most of is action. So this was like an idea, right? And a lot of people was like, oh, Martin Luther King, he died for the dream. Nah, he died fighting. Like, he died, like, actionable steps that we're going to take in order to create, sustainable change around the world. And we haven't gotten there yet. Of course we haven't gotten there yet. We just elected a egotistical, you know, racist, right? So when you think about his dream fulfilled, when you think about the foundations of this country and the foundations of different things around the world, like white supremacy ideologies around the world and what Martin Luther King was fighting against, these things are very much present, still present in societies and in many of the things that we examine and many of the things that we see. And I think for us, the speech and the dream was something that we can look to as a way to say, all right, this is what we're fighting for. Right. These are the things that, you know, we got to make sure that we every single day we wake up, we teaching our children to be better. And so I think the dream to me is more of a call to action each and every day that we wake up in order to resist and fight back what we've been doing since we got here and even before we got here.
That's right.
Yeah.
Okay. Awesome. I mean, this is just, you know, this is mind blowing to me because like you said, we're not there yet.
Yeah.
And because we're not there, you know, every single day we have to strive for that.
Oh, yeah.
You know, in any way, sometimes, you know, it's more challenging, especially with the youth.
Yeah.
You know, and I find because you work with the youth, you know, I was going to ask you today, you know, do you see them having that same honor and respect for Dr. Martin Luther King as, you know, maybe even we did when we were young, growing up, learning about it? You know, do you see that same value or is it just another day, you know, oh, we're out of school or no, this is a day we need to really celebrate?
Yeah, they follow our students, our children are a direct reflection of the adults that are raising them, right? So, you know, a lot of times people might say things about youth, but anytime someone says something about youth, the first thing that I push back on is that we are raising them, right? And I will say this, I've been serving students as long as I've been an adult, and they are powerful. Like, a lot of people don't give them the credit that they deserve, but I'm telling you, our youth, they about that, right? So when you think about, you know, just Trump being elected, like, they walking out of school.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I mean? Like, nah, we not having that. We walking out, right? So they still had that fight in them. They still had that fight in them. And I think oftentimes, you know, with the advent of social media, like, my push is always to the adults, right? And I remember watching them walk out, something that, you know, when you think about Martin Luther King and the Civil Rights Movement, the people that was being hosed on the front lines were students, right? They were students in high school, and they were getting permission from their parents to walk out. And this is something that, you know, the Civil Rights Movement orchestrated. And I was watching online, and when the students were walking out, and people were making these crazy comments like, "Why are they walking out?" And I'm like, This is it. Exactly. This is what we've been asking about. So what we need to do is get out in the streets with them.
Exactly.
Help them organize and channel their energy. Empower them. Speak some truth into them. Help them help guide that energy in the right way. But that is what we want. We want that. So our youth, they respect truth. They respect righteousness. They respect people pushing them and guiding them in the right direction. Right? They don't respect judgment. They don't respect, you know, people passing these judgments about them, right? And when you get down to the level that they're on and listen to them, they respect. Yeah, they respect anything that's truthful.
I definitely love the youth because, you know, they're our future, you know, and I'd rather them have fight in them than to just
all
be
day.
Dormant.
All day.
And have nothing to say.
All day. Just, I was talking to my supervisor and I was like, so what are we going to do? I just wanted to make sure we was on the same page. Like, what are we going to do if the students walk out? And we was like, make sure they got their coats.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? Because we bobbing with them, right? Exactly. And we're going to make sure they safe.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You know, being young, you know, we were there. Yeah. We were there before, and, you know, we had a voice. Mm-hmm. And sometimes no one listened to our voice because we were young. But
yeah.
Honestly, they pay attention a lot more mm-hmm. in some ways, you know. And it's unfortunate because you do have a lot of people who are older, and they may not have that same fight in them anymore. You know, they're so caught up in the day-to-day.
Yeah.
You know, got to go to work. I got to pay these bills. Mm-hmm. They're not focusing on some of these things, not realizing that, you know, some of these things that you're getting caught up in is going to keep you that way if you don't stand up and fight mm-hmm. for what you believe in. And I think that's powerful.
Yeah.
I think that's powerful. Yeah. That's why I absolutely love Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. for his sacrifice, because he stood up for exactly what he believed in. And you don't have to be violent to get the point across.
Yeah, yeah. And I think Dr. King, as beautiful as he is, and, you know, the day should be celebrated because Coretta was fighting like a mutt in order to get this day a national holiday, there were so many people around him, right? Mm-hmm. There were so many people around him who was pushing him and kind of cheering from the back. Mm-hmm. So many sisters, you know, working, and so many, you know, I mean, there were so many things taking place that King was, you know, a part of, and we were able to kind of see him. So when I celebrate King Day, it's one of those things like I'm celebrating the movement. I'm celebrating everybody who was able to make King a reality.
Yes.
Because his celebration is connected to so many other people's fight and so many other people's sacrifices. And I know, knowing King and what kind of man he was, he would definitely want that spirit in the room as well on a celebration of his day.
Awesome. Yes.
Yeah.
Definitely, definitely. Brother Grimes.
Sister T.
How you doing over there?
Man, I'm awesome.
Taking this in?
I'm learning.
Awesome, awesome, awesome. Yeah, that's what we're here to do. That's exactly why we have you here, just to learn from you, because, you know, people need this, especially, honestly, you know, I feel that something happened after the Civil Rights Movement. You know, you can see, you know, women starting to stick together. You can see that. But right now, as far as our community, we need that type of unity. You know, we need those type of people, you know, that's going to support you, push you,
mm-hmm.
push you in the right direction. So what would you say to the person who, you know, may have that dream, may want to do something, doesn't quite have the supporters? What would you say to that person?
I think, like, the biggest thing that I say is it's crazy, because I was talking to one of my sisters yesterday, and she was asking me about organizing her school and organizing the teachers in her school, because she feel her school is kind of not where it's supposed to be. And she was asking me some advice around it.
Okay.
And what I told her was, the biggest thing that you can do is not give yourself any restrictions or limitations.
Okay.
Right? Like, you, I think it's powerful if you don't feel like you're limited by anybody or anything.
Okay.
And so I'll always tell people, like, I don't have a boss.
Okay.
Like, no, like, I work in a school. I'm the vice principal. Of course, I have people who, I have supervisors.
Okay.
But I have nobody who bosses me, right? And so, and I say that in the most humble way possible, but I always want in my mind to understand that I am capable of doing whatever I want. And that has to be an understanding, especially when I'm fighting for the liberation of people, right? Yeah. I have to know and understand that, like, I cannot and should not be controlled. I should take advice.
Okay.
I should take guidance. I should take, advice from my elders,
mm-hmm.
And the youth. But ultimately, I have to understand that nobody tells me what to do. And I think the biggest advice that I can give to people who are in the fight is to understand that there are no rules to freedom. Like, you fight in whichever way that you can. So some people might be fighting with their own health,
mm-hmm.
right? I'm going to eat right. I'm going to, you know, show people that, you know, what a healthy lifestyle looks like. Some people might be fighting in corporate America. You know, some people might be fighting in the street with entrepreneurship, right? So it's so many ways. But I think what we have to do as a people is to be able to see where the beauty lies and what people are doing to fight, and then support that fight in whichever way possible. And understand that the fight don't necessarily got to look like the same way you doing it.
Okay.
Like, you know what I mean? Everybody can't be a teacher. People don't like middle school kids,
true.
Right?
So, that's true.
So you got to have patience for that, right?
You definitely do.
But I do need somebody in the office that I can call on. Like, look, I want to take kids to Africa. What are we going to do? And I need you to be aligned in the same way. Right. And so that's what I think we can do is to make sure that we support one another and make sure that we see how people are fighting in different ways.
Awesome. Yeah. Awesome. 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 So when dealing with, you know, the youth, because, you know, that's a big part of what you do, do you see the parents as open and as willing to be a good help when you see them, their children fighting for something? Do you see their parents that's contributing to that? Or do you see them kind of like, you know, just go do you?
Yeah. I mean, what Pac has, is that Pac? Yeah, that is Pac. He had a quote, and he talked about, like, if over 25 years old,
okay,
it's a wrap. Like, you know, once you get over 25, your energy kind of dies down, right? And so you see parents supporting in a variety of different ways.
Okay.
But, you know, parents are nervous, right? So if my son was out in the street, I'm nervous,
yeah,
right? Like,
that's true.
As much fight as I got in me, if my son get out there, I'm like, hey, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
I got to protect him.
Yeah,
and so it's a natural... You know what I mean? Is a order of things. And, you know, we got nervousness in us. We got responsibilities. We scared to a certain degree. But at the same time, I think it's just us being guided. Like, and I'm thinking about my son. If my son, because my son is a fighter. Like, he's 9 and he's just a firecracker, ready.
All right.
Right? Nice. Able to call out sexism and racism and oppression. Like, he can say it and spot it. And I'm so proud of him. But I know at 9, when you get like 15 and 16, like that fight is going to get a little different. So I just, you know, but, and I can't say that and I'm scared. So I, thinking about from the parent perspective, you know, it's a tough decision to make to support your kids when they fighting back and they're resisting. But I think it's a decision that we have to make.
Awesome. Awesome. You know? All right. So we're going to actually take a break on that note. But I mean, this is awesome.
Cool,
this is like cool for the soul. So we're going to take a break and we will be right back, world.
All right.
All right.
I'm trying. It ain't quite working out for me. But you know, it's all good. It's all good.
We'll make it happen.
Yeah.
All right. Awesome. Awesome. Well, we're back live with Brother Victorious Hall and Mr. Bubba Grimes here. And so I actually want to bring Roland in because I want to ask him a few things and have him chime in because, you know, we have different age groups here. So yeah. I want to be able to offer feedback and things that maybe you've seen, you know, post civil rights movement and different transitions that you've had. So I definitely want to leave you out as well.
Yeah. Well, the first thing is the civil rights movement that we knew of in the 60s was essentially about human rights and spreading it across gender lines, color lines, etc. And one of the things that Martin Luther King espoused was a universal freedom and universal opportunity, universal equity. So therefore, it wasn't just a black thing. It wasn't just a movement for what we now call ourselves African Americans. It was essentially for the same kind of peace and opportunity for all human beings. The plus side of that is a lot of folks benefited from it. The negative side of it is we didn't get our 40 acres and a mule. You know, so one of the things that happens when you make something very inclusive is sometimes you get excluded. So along the way, toward the tail end of it, he started to shift a little bit. And he started to make comments and put rhetoric out that said, you know what, I can no longer tell my people to be nonviolent in the face of folks smacking them in the head. That's not working for me now. And then, more importantly, one of the things that I was told by another historian is prior to being killed, he was on his way to Detroit to give a speech, this time about economic rights.
Mm-hmm.
Once he moved into the arena of economic empowerment for black folks, now he became not just... Until then, he was progressive. Then it became dangerous because everybody in power knows that when a group of people decides to develop economic strength and empowerment, that all bets are off. Because now what you've done is you've leveled the playing field.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the biggest thing that I think we lost over 40, 50 years. Is that we still have not figured out how to deal with economic empowerment. You look at the football games yesterday, you know, where 90%, almost 90% of one defense is African American, right? It's black. You look in the stands, you look at the people controlling the purse strings, what do they look?
Mm-hmm.
They look like us?
Nah.
You know, but yet we play this game. Without us playing this game is totally different.
Hey.
Well, why can't we own the game? Well, in order for us to own the game, guys like me have to put that in motion. And then people like you have to join me. And then we have to go and we have to do financing. The problem with that is that we then start losing our families and we start losing our friends. When Walt Disney decided to do Disney, do you think folks said, hey, man, it's a great idea for you to take a mouse, which was one of the most hated creatures on earth, and turn it to, you know, the most lovable caricature on TV?
Yeah.
A freaking mouse. You think folks was like, yeah, that's a great idea, Walt. Let's go do it. They say, you out your damn mind. And then you're going to put a mute. People walk away from you when you decide to do something great economically. And the one thing, and I apologize for this sister, and I apologize for this brother, but one of the things that if we don't get this right, we are going to disappear. If we don't figure out a way to stay together, work together, make money together, save money together, empower one another, we're going to just get plucked like fish in a barrel. We're going to get plucked off much easier.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true.
But, you know, in that, you know, and kind of adding to that, you know, I had the opportunity to kind of travel, not kind of travel, but to travel to the African American History Museum. And also just, you know, just been reading. And you're able to understand exactly to that point, right? Like what we have been doing, black people have been doing since we got here in order to combine our money into, you know, and to speak of economic empowerment. Like, you know, our communities were destroyed, right? So when you think of Tulsa, you think of places, I mean, these things were destroyed by, you know, white supremacist groups, the American government. So when we are able to kind of put our foot forward and actually connect, and like he said, I think one of the biggest things we have to do is we have to understand how to defend.
Yeah.
How to defend our communities and how to defend our resources and the things that we have, because it's a serious situation, because we are under attack, and no one, and the things that we, when we are able to produce and when we are able to actually begin to create some change, you know, it's not as if it is not attacked. Okay. And we have several examples of that. Yes. You know, so
definitely. And for the people who are watching live, I want to give you guys an opportunity to call in. So there's a phone number above my head. Also, I'm going to just give you that number. It's 240-455-5934. Call in if you have any questions.
Yeah, any questions
that you have, give them a call. Give us a call if you have any questions. Feel free. You can comment on Facebook Live for those watching on Facebook Live and any other live channels. Please give a call. So I just wanted to plug that in. This is awesome information, because, you know, we need this. And like you said, we are being attacked. So we need to find a way to really come together, support one another, just love each other, because yeah. we need love.
And that's an interesting point of clarification. Part of what he's saying is that when we move, we get attacked.
That's right.
Right now, what folks are doing is just sitting back watching us sleep. You know, so what happens is when we're not trying to advance our own ownership, progression, et cetera, people don't have to do anything. They don't have to attack us. Politically, economically, legally, they don't have to. They can pass whatever laws, they can do whatever they want. The enemies around us don't have to do anything, because we're not creating any kind of force in a direction that changes the landscape of the way things are. When we start doing stuff like this, that's when we have to be prepared to be attacked. And honestly speaking, because a lot of us don't want to have to defend that stuff, and we don't want to see the breakdown of our families and friends and relationships, we don't venture out to do these kinds of things and empower one another, because of the loss and the stress that goes with it. So as long as I stay dormant, no one's going to attack me. Period. Yeah. It's like being a football player. If I don't run with the ball, there's no need to hit me.
Yeah.
I'm standing there.
And also, you know, this idea of what it means to actually have the knowledge to fight. I think that, you know, my brother and I, Alfred Duncan, just wrote a book, and one of the things that we wrote inside of the book was I told a story about football. You were talking about football, and you know, kind of this thing that we are very much involved and very much attached to things that produce no results. So it's no real result for our families. It's no real result for our community.
No, we win the Super Bowl, would change.
Yeah, no. So it's to me. And I respect the idea of, you know, relaxation and entertainment. So I never want to get that twisted, right? Like, so I understand why people want to enjoy that. But when it comes to the point where we can be as I just want to see us be as passionate about cooperative economics, be as passionate about creating things for our youth, be as passionate about rebuilding our families. When we are as passionate about football as we are those things,
yes.
You know, if we spend that amount of time, like, you know, if you watch two games on a Sunday, right, that's 8 hours, 6 hours of your day on a Sunday. Imagine if we put that to, you know what I mean, to work. I imagine what we can do. So I'm not anti-football. I'm just anti production and you know, kind of pushing through in our communities.
Yes, awesome. And one of the things that I'm doing this month, I've been eliminating television. I haven't been watching any TV. And yeah. That has been so empowering, because I realized that there's so much stuff I can do. Yeah. And there's so many things that I've actually been able to just get done without a hesitation, because I'm not spending any
that
time
is impressive.
Watching television.
And I'm gonna give you the pound. That is impressive.
And, you know, people ask me all the time, did you see this show? Did you see that show? I'm like, no. You know,
yeah.
Because when you're really out there doing the things that you are passionate about and not not just, you know, football, and not just sports. And like I said, I'm not anti-football either. I just find other things to do with that much time in the day. And like you said, we have to raise up our people. We have to raise up our youth, because the youth are so powerful. So I spend a lot of time, you know.
They are the most powerful.
They are.
We better start raising our adults. Your phone call.
All right. So we have a caller.
Hello, who's on the line?
Hello.
Hello.
I was talking about when you guys were talking about the kids walking out of school. I was saying that when kids walk, they shouldn't be judged by why kids are walking out of school, because it makes sense. We're going through so much racist stuff, and we should react to it.
Yeah, that's dope. That's my son.
Oh, awesome.
That's my son. I'm with that. I'm in full support of reacting to oppression. I'm in full support of that, King.
Yes,
full
support of that. Awesome.
Full support of
that.
Hi,
King.
Hello.
How you doing?
Good.
Awesome.
Dope.
That
dope,
is dope. Yeah, I mean, you don't know. Kids are going through a lot, you know. They're experiencing so much at a young age, and they don't know, you know, what to do. And if they don't have that support, they're not going to know what to do. It's our job to really steer them in the right direction.
Yeah, true.
All right, awesome. So back to in celebration of Martin Luther King Day and just the things that we've learned just today, you know, moving forward. Let's talk about moving forward.
Yeah.
You know, what is one of the things that we can do right now, starting today, to really make things happen? Because I know that it takes us.
Yeah.
You know, it takes us. You got to start at your own home.
Yeah.
You know, what
there you
doing.
Go. That's you it. Tangible steps. Read more. Tangible steps. Read more.
Awesome.
And work on uniting your family. I was talking to my wife, this is probably like a couple months ago, and she said, one of the most revolutionary things we can do is to love our spouses, right? And to love our children. One of the most revolutionary things that you can do in this moment right now is to love your spouse,
Dude, your wife is incredible.
Yeah, oh no, she is.
And I'm going to say this to you in no uncertain terms, bro. Yeah. The thing that's devastating us more than anything is divorce.
Yeah.
And what happens is, how do you put a community together? How do you put a neighborhood together? How do you put a family together if mom and dad ain't standing
together?
Yeah. You know, so, I rarely hear that from my people.
Yeah.
Most especially my sisters.
Yeah.
Where is she from?
Yeah. She taken, but she... she's from here. She's from Prince George's County. She was Prince George's County.
For real?
Yeah, yes. She's a powerhouse, man.
She is.
She's a powerhouse. But in this idea about, like, when you think about the catalyst for change, you know, that catalyst for change is that family. You just got it.
That's all them hits in football.
It's called
a delayed reaction.
I respect it. But that's one of the greatest things that we can do, along with, you know, not just reading your Facebook or your Instagram or your Twitter timeline, right? Like, you have to get into to books and, like, study and research and understand. You know, my father was a major proponent of knowledge of yourself, right? And I think one of the biggest things we can do as a people is to know who we are. Like, who we are, not in America, but who we've been for thousands upon thousands upon thousands of years. And once you empower people and get them to understand who they are, like, that's why when Trump's president, I'm like, you know who I am?
Yeah.
Like, and so once you get that in your soul, you know, what's going to stop?
So you had a father in your life?
Oh, yeah. Father.
Awesome father.
Okay. An amazing father.
His dad's dope.
Okay.
Like, he's dope.
Remember, I just need to ask you, right?
Yeah.
No, so, he's dope.
So, fatherhood, I had a gentleman call last week by the name of Eton Thomas. And without going into any more about it, you can go back and listen to the show. The reality of lack of fatherhood, you talk about history, the lineage, ancestry, et cetera. And a lot of that runs through the blood of the seed of the man. The blood of the seed of the man. So I tell you this one very interesting thing that really changed a lot of how I viewed even some of the simplest fatherhood and how we struggle with it even to this day. So I was in Syracuse where I went to school, and I was doing some business, and my father was there with me. And a young man walked in. He's 42 years old at the time. And he came in, and he's, you know, I said, "Hey, Lamar, how you doing?" He said, "Good, good." You know, boom, dapped each other up, love yeah. brother, et cetera. I said, "I want to introduce you to my father." You know, blah, blah, blah. He said, "Okay, hey, how you doing?" "Wait a minute. You what?" I said, "My father." He said, "No, seriously." I said, "My father." He said, "Father, like your biological father?" Yeah. I said, "Yeah, man, my biological father." He leans back. Tears start coming out of his eyes. He said, "Dude, I'm 40 years old, 42 years old. He said, "I've never seen a black man with a father."
Wow.
He said, "Most of the black men I know don't even know who their father is."
Yeah, that's
he grew up in New York, in the New York City area. He said in his lifetime, he had never seen a black man standing with his father in his lifetime.
Yeah. And so I'm glad that ain't wasn't my experience, but right. you know what I'm saying? But I get it, right? And so, and for many of, you know, there is a population of young people who need male guidance, right? Yes. There's a population of young people who need that male energy. And I think that, you know, both the father and the mother, right, working together, balancing that energy and pouring that into children, is what our community needs a lot of.
Yes.
And I think, you know, and I could talk about the historical ramifications that have caused fatherless homes and, you know, black male masculinity and the psyche of black men and, you know, kind of what's causing many of these malfunctions or, you know, these things that are happening in our community. They're not just like, you know, we ain't just wake up and say we don't want to be no fathers.
Exactly.
Right? Like, we've been dads, right? Like, fatherhood started with us, right?
Right?
So when you think about an abnormality inside of your community, it comes and it stems from something. And when you look at the institution of slavery, when you look at Jim Crow, when you look at the American welfare system, when you look at a variety of different things that have kind of set up an opportunity for us, not for many men, not to be successful. And then you also add in misinformation given to black men about what black male masculinity is.
Right.
Right. When you put all that in one stew, you know, you create a variety of different abnormalities. But I would be remiss to say that it ain't no soldiers out here, because we out here.
Yeah.
Every one of my brothers. Every one of my family members, every one of my brothers, we out here trying our best.
Yes.
So we out here, but you know, we're not the ones broadcasting. You know,
right.
So it's just very important that we keep that in mind too. That there's soldiers on the. You know, I was just talking to my man. We was riding to breakfast today, talking to my man about fatherhood, about some ways in which we can improve ourselves,
okay.
And ways in which we can, you know, sharpen our sword as dads. You know, having a conversation with my son today, just before I came here, about how I can be a better dad to him.
Awesome.
So these things are, you know, constantly on our minds, things we're trying to do and get
awesome,
better at.
Awesome.
Yeah,
I think we need more of that, and I think we need to broadcast more of that.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
You know, that's one of the reasons, like I said, why I wanted to have you on the show today, because
yeah.
It's just needed. We need that. Seeing what a father looks like, seeing what we can do together, women and men.
Yeah.
I really think, you know, right after the election and the inauguration, there's going to be a women's march. So
I think that is huge. Yeah.
Well, I'll be down there. And I think that's going to be so huge, because just like when you see different movements,
mm-hmm.
Women, we have to come together also.
Oh, yeah. What?
If
no,
we can all come together.
No, women are, you know, let's be, you know, all the way. Like, you know, women, especially, you know, with a strong emphasis on black women. I'm only going to talk about black women,
yep.
Right? Like, to understand and know the power of black women. And that's something that black men got to sit in, too.
Yes.
You know, with our own gender stereotypes, like, the black men need to sit in where you come from and understand who the black woman is,
yes.
And be able to, you know, respect and show reverence to who they are.
Yes.
And who they are is the most high, right?
Yes.
So when you think about what we come out of,
yep.
And who incubates, you know what I'm saying?
You saying yes with a whole lot of enthusiasm.
Nah,
like,
that's
yeah.
Not real. But nah, I mean, like, yeah. You got to reshape, you know, these ideas about, you know, masculinity.
Yep.
Who created these rules, right?
That's
who
right.
Created these ideas? And we got to question all of that.
Yes.
You know, so yeah, black women. Yeah, we've been talking about men, but black womanhood and motherhood is essential
yes.
In the development of a child.
Yes.
You know, essential.
definitely, definitely. So, I mean, this right here, this is awesome, awesome. So I want to thank you again for just taking the time out of coming today, you know, to leave on a really good note. Like, what's the one thing that you want to leave the people with before you leave today?
I think the biggest thing I want to leave is, like, let's keep fighting, you know? Like, you know, a lot of people are all up in arms about Trump. I don't want to be in the country when he inaugurated, too. So, I get it. But man, we are people, man. We fought through so much, man. Like, we created civilizations before. You know, we were the originators. So, like, ain't really nothing to worry about. Like, we going to be here. You know, they've been trying to kill us for a long time, but they can't. And you know what I mean? They've been trying to kill us for a while, but it ain't no way. We going to be here.
Yeah.
We like roaches, right? We going to be here. What they say? That's on the Nas CDs. Or anybody listen to Nas, right? But that, and you know, and I'm honored to be here. I'm honored to, you know, to be asked to come and share my spirit and share my soul and my voice. So I appreciate the invite. Thank you know, you. And definitely, buy the book.
Yes,
buy the book. Definitely. Buy the book, man.
Yes,
uplifting.
Put it out there.
Man uplifting. Buy the book.
Okay.
You know, because I worked hard on it.
Yes.
So, but you know, we wrote it. Myself and Alfred Duncan wrote it because we wanted to try to provide a different perspective on manhood and to provide a different lens to young people about what manhood should look like. Not in a very preachy way, but, you know, kind of a way through stories. But please check the book out because I feel like it's dope because, you know. Because we wrote it.
Right.
So, yeah.
It just makes sense.
Uh-huh.
All right. Awesome. So, Mr. Grimes.
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Anything you want to leave out with before we leave today?
As you can see, I was multitasking. Mr. Grimes. Mr. Grimes now. No, thank you. Appreciate you coming.
Appreciate you, man.
And let's keep it moving, man.
All right.
Yes. Awesome, awesome. So, I mean, you guys, we're going to share the link with you guys for those who didn't get to watch. But we're going to be here on Monday. So, you know, if you have any questions, like, comment, share this information. I really think it's something that can help change a lot of people's perspective, and we need it in our community. So, thank you again for coming out for our Martin Luther King celebration. And world, thank you for watching.
Peace.
dog that chases his tail will definitely be dizzy.
Nope, don't hang.
What you mean, no?
You ain't push the call button.
Oh, that'll do.
Oh, I got you.
So, Super Stupid bought a 5-cent bag. Thought it was cold, but it was Skag.
Okay, there you go. Okay, Super Stupid, you got it.
Think you're the first woman who's tried to save him.